From Philadelphia, I'm Terry Gross with Fresh Air. There's no business like show business. They say it's wonderful. I Got the Sun in the Morning and Anything You Can Do are just some of the now classic songs from Irving Berlin's 1946 musical, Annie Get Your Gun. There's a new recording of Annie, conducted by John McGlinn, who specializes in restorations of Broadway musicals. Coming up, we'll hear the results and meet McGlinn. Also, film critic Stephen Schiff reviews Howard's End, the new movie based on the E.M. Forster novel. The movie was made by the same team who did Room with a View. That's all coming up on Fresh Air. This is Fresh Air.
Anything you can do, I can do better. I can do anything better than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
Anything you can be, I can be greater. Sooner or later, I'm greater than you.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am. Yes, I am. I can shoot a partridge with a single cartridge.
I can get a sparrow with a bow and arrow.
I can live on bread and cheese.
And only on that?
Yeah.
So can a rat.
Any note you can reach, I can go higher.
I can sing anything higher than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
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 Irving Berlin's 1946 musical, Annie Get Your Gun, is among the best-loved Broadway shows, and just about all musical comedy fans have a copy of Annie in their collections. What you've just heard is from a new recording of it, which uses the original orchestrations and includes music that has never been recorded before. It's conducted by my guest, John McGlinn, and features Kim Criswell as Annie Oakley, the role Ethel Merman made famous, and Thomas Hampson as fellow sharpshooter and love interest Frank Butler. They're accompanied by the London Sinfonietta and Ambrosian Chorus. McGlinn is no stranger to resurrecting original scores. He's also conducted and recorded restored versions of Showboat, Anything Goes, Kiss Me Kate, as well as overtures and songs by Jerome Kern, George Gershwin, and Rodgers and Hart. McGlinn studied singing before becoming a conductor. I asked John McGlinn why he wanted to restore Annie Get Your Gun.
At first, I didn't want to do Annie Get Your Gun. I shouldn't confess that over public radio, but it's true. When EMI first came to me and they said, the next thing we'd really like you to do is Annie Get Your Gun, and I thought to myself, well, oh, golly, gee whiz, I love Annie Get Your Gun, but that's sort of like asking you to remake Mary Poppins or Gone with the Wind or something, you know? Then I actually started to do my homework on the show, and I realized that Annie Get Your Gun, I should explain, exists in two entirely separate and discrete versions. There is the original show that opened in 1946 at the Imperial Theater in New York City, and there was a very famous revival supervised by Irving Berlin in 1966 at Lincoln Center. That production also starred Ethel Merman and was recorded by RCA Victor. And for that production, the original orchestrations were thrown out, new orchestrations were done by Robert Russell Bennett, and some of the score was dropped, a new song was added, the book was shortened, two subsidiary characters were eliminated entirely, and that version, what I would call the Lincoln Center version, is the one that is, and in fact, the only version that is currently available for rental and performance. And so I realized that there was a real palpable need, a real reason to go back and record the original 1946 version.
You were talking about the 1966 version and how that's been the only one available in terms of the score. Let me play the overture, the opening of the overture from the 1966 version, and compare that to the restored version that you've done. And I think our listeners will hear that the 1966 version is very heavy on strings and harps, whereas yours is crisper, and there's more horns in it.
Well, you know what there is in the original that there isn't in the 66 version is five saxophones.
Right.
The saxophones were completely eliminated from the 66 version.
And replaced by violins, probably.
Yeah, and more brass.
So I'm gonna start with the 1966, and then I'll go back go to your new restoration. You compare these two?
Well, first of all, let me say that I don't want to be seen in any way to be knocking the 1966 version. It's worth remembering, first of all, Irving Berlin supervised the 66 version,
mm-hmm.
and it was orchestrated by Robert Russell Bennett, who had done a large portion of the orchestrations of the original production. It was reorchestrated for one definite reason and a second reason that I suspect, which I didn't realize until last year. First of all, this production was designed for the New York State Theater. And that is a big house. And I think they felt that orchestrations were needed that would be louder, heavier, punchier, and more in the style of the 1960s. Broadway orchestrations, even though they were very peppy in the 40s, tended to be more delicate. By the 60s, we were into the age of amplification, and it was a huge hall that needed a great deal of sound to fill it. That, I think, is partly the reason. Also, I think it was felt that the sound of the saxophones and that whole 1940s sound would sound dated to 60s mentality.
What's interesting is that it's the 1966 version that I think really sounds dated.
Now it does, because you know what it is? It's very interesting. I found that this applies to so many of these shows that people go back and doctor. It's what I call malice of hindsight. And you... when something is created new, you're simply creating it. You're doing what is in your heart, what is all around you musically and culturally. You are going with the flow of what you're in the middle of living in. You're not consciously second-guessing yourself. When you go back 20 years later, they did this with Showboat as well, and you try to do new arrangements which are not so much in the style of the 1940s as in what they think people think the style of the 40s was, it never sounds right. It always sounds slightly ersatz, slightly artificial.
My guest is conductor John McGlinn, who's made a new recording of Annie Get Your Gun. More after this short break. This is Fresh Air. My guest is John McGlinn, who specializes in recording restorations of original scores of Broadway musicals. His latest recording is Annie Get Your Gun. The big shows on Broadway now include the revival of Guys and Dolls and a kind of reconstituted musical, Crazy for You, which has songs from the Gershwins with a new book.
Well, you know, it's quite extraordinary. You walk down 45th Street. I mean, we're recording this interview in April of 1992, and it's rather amazing to walk down 45th Street and see, up in lights, on two different marquees, Guys and Dolls and The Most Happy Fella,
right.
Two Frank Lesser shows on the same street, and just across Schubert Alley, there's a Gershwin show playing. That's really kind of a wonderful thing when you think about it.
What does it say to you, though, that the big successful musicals, for the most part, are from the past?
Well, I think it says what a lot of us have always suspected, which is there's a great deal more to these pieces than simply ephemeral entertainment, which is certainly what their creators, for the most part, thought they were. They were written for the season that they were written for. I don't think they ever thought that people would go back and consider them great, precious legacies from the past. But the shows that were really well written, where the music was, you know, deep and rich and funny and happy and giddy, we live in a time that is so devoid of a lot of that, that it all seems new now. I mean, there are two, not one, but two whole generations of people who have never seen Guys and Dolls on the stage. And if you've never seen it, it's new to you. So there's a, just like there's a whole legacy of operas that people go to time and time and time and time again and never get tired of, people are just now realizing what an incredible treasure trove of material has been left behind from, you know, say 1915 to 1955.
Do you sing anymore? I mean, you have a small credit on the Annie Get Your Gun recording. You're on the reprise of There's No Business Like Show Business. I'm not sure if you're just speaking a line there, if you're actually singing.
I sing at rehearsal. I sing when someone's missing. I have, I say modestly, a very pretty little teeny-weeny tiny tenor voice. But it was much too small to do anything with operatically, which is what I wanted to do. And I stopped singing for a very practical reason, which is that it terrified me so that, I mean, I would shake and I would vomit and, oh, it was just horrible. And I thought, this is no life for an adult human being. I'm terribly glad that I went through that. I studied voice for 8 years. I took 3 lessons a week. And I performed in college and all of that. I know what kind of hell singers go through when they perform. And that's terribly useful to me as a conductor. I can hear, before it happens, when a singer is about to run out of breath. I can hear coming out of the throat when the singer needs just that little bit of extra room to get over the register break for a high note. I can hear all of that, or I can sense it and intuit it. And it's been the most useful training as a conductor for singers that I could have ever had. And if, as I hope, I eventually end up conducting operas, it will come even into greater use. And I think it's one of the reasons singers like working with me so much, is that unlike some conductors, I'm extremely sympathetic to the physical demands of what a singer has to endure in order to produce the sounds they do.
So where can we hear you on the new record?
Oh, on Annie Get Your Gun, I do a couple of lines of dialogue as Mac, the stage manager, and in the reprise of No Business Like Show Business. So when you hear him going, "Hey, Annie, you better get ready, motor bicycle's all polished up," that's me.
Okay. Now, I have a confession to make. I'm sure you'll think this is an awful thing to say. I have never been a fan of Ethel Merman's. There, I've said it.
Many people feel the same way.
Yeah. But you really love her singing.
Well, it's worth remembering that Ethel Merman started her performing career in 1929, and the voice changed substantially over the years. Now, if you play an Ethel Merman recording from 1930, 1934, 30, you know, anything in the 30s, or look at her Paramount two-reeler shorts from 1929, the voice is very different from that sort of big, loud, leathery sound that you will hear in Gypsy and in the later revival of Annie Get Your Gun. I mean, remember, by that point, she was in her mid-50s. And any voice, especially a voice that was used with such strength and frequency as hers was, is going to weather badly. I mean, if you go back and listen to Merman as she was when she became a great star, you will hear a voice of exceptional purity, a voice that was not so much huge as crystal clear and, you know, like a laser beam.
Now, I have to ask you about There's No Business Like Show Business, which is, you know, the anthem from the show.
Mm-hmm.
Did you go into this still loving that song, or was the song really tired for you, and did you have to work to make it fresh?
No, it wasn't tired for me at all, because, you see, I have a trick. Whenever I feel that something is getting tired for me, I avoid it like the plague,
mm-hmm.
and I go away from it. And that way it stays fresh. I mean, I haven't spent all of my life doing There's no business like show business, so it isn't old for me.
Mm-hmm.
Now, sure, you hear it all the time. You hear it sung at the end of every Tony Award ceremony, all that kind of stuff. And it's become so much, you know, a part of our bloodstream that you don't think of it. But when you're doing it in the context of the play and you're using the theater orchestration, you're suddenly, instead of just everybody sort of getting up and singing a song they half know, you're dealing with a song that suddenly has a very specific emotional and theatrical point, which is they are trying to persuade Annie to leave home, to leave Dark County, Ohio, and come with them, join the circus, join the Wild West show. And she's very unsure, so they use this song to get her excited about going into show business. So the situation was unique and fresh and had a dramatic need. There was a reason the song needed to be sung. And when you're working under those kind of circumstances, something can't get old.
Well, John McGlinn, I want to thank you a lot for talking with us.
Well, my pleasure. Thank you.
John McGlinn's new recording of Annie Get Your Gun is on EMI.
Annie, have you ever been away from home before?
Do I gotta leave home?
Sure. We travel all over the country.
Have you ever been on a railroad train?
Uh-uh.
Do you know anything about show business?
Show business? What show business?
The cowboys, the wrestlers, the tumblers, the clowns, the roustabouts that move the show at dawn.
The music, the spotlights, the people, the towns, your baggage with the labels pasted on.
The sawdust and the horses and the smell. The towel you've taken from the last hotel.
There's no business like show business, like no business I know.
Everything about it is appealing,
everything the traffic will allow.
Know that when you get that happy feeling, when you are stealing that extra bow.
There's no people like show.
This is Fresh Air.